So, welcome back. In this module, we've discussed the relation between music and ethics. And the relation between music and ethics is based on the idea that music has an influence on our behavior, and judgments about good or bad behavior are thought to be ethical judgments. And this brings music into the sphere of ethics. We have seen that music can be a source for virtuous and hospitable behavior. In addition, we have seen that the education and performance of music can play an important role when it comes to people's development into fully flourishing members of society. One of the relations that is perhaps least expected is the one between music and hospitality. In this view, ethically good behavior can be understood as a form of hospitality, where you treat the other, in this case the other is not a person but a piece of music, like a benevolent host. You are opening yourself up to receive the music in a non-judgmental and well-willing way, thereby suspending immediate judgments. Two concepts seem to be very important here. There obviously is a responsibility to be a good host, but being a good host also entails that you allow your guests sufficient freedom to do as they please.
Yeah, I would like to come back to this idea of hospitality and responsibility.
Yes.
Not so much in the listening of music, but basically taking place in the interactions when musicians are performing on stage or in the studio.
Yes.
Now, as an example, let's listen for a while to this. Mm. It's a piece played by three musicians: John Zorn on saxophone, George Lewis on trombone, and Derek Bailey on guitar. Now, this is a very short excerpt from a much longer piece, but what you can hear is that in principle people, these musicians, have all the freedom to play whatever they want, at least to a certain extent. That's why it's often called free improvisation. But simultaneously they are interacting with one another, so they listen to what the other one is playing. They can add harmonies to what the other one is playing, they can imitate the kind of phrases that the other one is playing, they can use a rhythmic motif that is used by somebody else. So what I mean to say is that they have to be very hospitable to what the other one is doing. So they have to listen and react to what the other one is doing. Simultaneously, however, they are also responsible for the piece as a whole. Mm. Which means that at a certain moment, and I think this is a very important aspect in which music can contribute to the ideas that we have about ethics and morality, so as they are responsible for the piece as a whole, sometimes it can be the case that they go against what somebody else is playing. So you don't only have to adapt yourself to what the other one is doing, but perhaps sometimes you think, no, I want to throw in another idea, or this is not very interesting what this guy is playing, so I'm going to do something completely different.
Yeah.
So actually there are two things that are important here. One is that when we talk about music, of course we can talk about aesthetic value. A piece of music should be beautiful or interesting or challenging. But simultaneously what is going on is that there are social or even socio-ethical interactions taking place between the musicians. The second thing that I want to make clear is that as this is free improvisation, those norms and values are not predetermined. They are not set in advance, but actually they are developed while playing the piece of music.
Yeah.
So I think there's a kind of ethical responsibility which is not preset, which is not covered by rules and by regulations, but actually discovered while playing the piece of music.
I mean, I see the point you're making. I think it's really interesting that this music challenges you not only to be a hospitable host, but even to take your own ethical rules, if we may call them, you know, take those under the loop and challenge them as such in order to meet one another musically. However, as a naive listener, I find it really hard to be a good host towards this music. So how about this tension that we just listen to stuff and some things appeal to us and these things perhaps appeal less to us, or we might even say that we find it ugly?
Yeah, well, for one thing, I don't want to convince anybody to like this music. Mm. So I don't want to say, hey, this music is better than other music. That is not something that I have in mind here. But let's compare it to food, for example. Now, you love Italian food. You eat it every day. And now one day I'm going to take you to a Chinese restaurant. Mm. So just to give you the possibility to taste something new, to taste some food that you've never tasted before. Now, if you're going to that restaurant with the idea in your mind that you will taste Italian food,
sure,
then of course you will dislike this Chinese food. Maybe the same with this music. If you listen to this music with the same ears and mindset as towards when you listen to music of DJ Tiesto or whomever you listen to, then of course you will find this music ugly or noisy or uninteresting.
Yeah.
But the same as with the food, perhaps you can open yourself for some new tastes in music as well. Or perhaps, and the best way perhaps is to start asking yourself questions about this music. So what have I heard? Which instruments are playing actually? Why these three? Which is a kind of weird combination, saxophone, guitar and trombone. So no drums, no bass. So why is that? And perhaps you heard some interesting sounds in the music. Can you say something about these sounds? Or perhaps you can compare this music to other music that you've heard. So where is the difference? Where are perhaps the similarities? So by asking yourself all these questions about the music, you maybe might erase in yourself some kind of curiosity and thereby some openness to what this music is presenting to you.
Sure, sure. It's a very radical form of openness where you actually challenge the rules you apply when you listen to music in the first place, or perhaps the rules you apply when you are discussing with someone, or when you're behaving in an ethical or unethical way. So that constellation of norms and values is actually broken down to the ground. And what Zorn is doing is he's asking us to be at peace with that and from the music try to build up new norms and values. Is that a fair summation of what you're saying?
That's a quite good summary, and it's also possible because of this omnipresence of music,
sure,
that we can have access to all kinds of music at all times.
Mm.
Which actually brings me to another question, which I think is a rather urgent one, and that is about this availability of music, which
sure
is basically taking place these days through streaming services to downloads which are often freely available, made available by certain enterprises. Now, of course, this is actually a very ethical or moral question. So what about this streaming? What about this free download?
Yeah.
So is it ethically or morally defendable in a way?
Yeah, well, I think that's a really important question because we do live in a digital age, right? So, and one of the most important sources of music nowadays is the internet, with all the streaming services and download services and platforms like YouTube. So first of all, I want to make a really simple observation, and I'm sure you don't have to be an ethicist or philosopher to see that illegal downloading or illegal streaming is basically it's wrong. It's morally indefensible, I think. So I just want to put it out there, so there's just to be uncontroversial about this point. However, moving forward, I think what this emergence of technology and the way we react towards this new developments has brought us is really interesting from an ethical perspective, because I think it shows us two things. First of all, I think it shows that we are fundamentally also sharing creatures. So we tend to share our music. So now let me focus, for example, on something like YouTube. I mean, there's so many videos there of people playing the guitar, showing like, hey, I transcribed this solo, or hey, learn to play the guitar and I'll show you the chords. So that's I think, a wonderful development. I think it shows an ethical quality we have.
But here with the streaming and downloading, we are actually harming musicians.
We are.
So, yes. I mean, they try to make a living out of music, and with this streaming service, they practically earn nothing.
That's absolutely true. And that's why all these modern phenomena, they have within them conflicting elements. So on the one hand, I think the sharing component is very ethically valuable. I think it's a wonderful thing to do. However, in the same time, we're also harming others, whether we know it or not. So that's absolutely a fair assessment you make there. And I think there's even one thing more, and that's that, I mean, if I look at myself, like when I first got internet, I started to download so much music. I mean, in all honesty, I've never heard all the music I had on my playlist or downloaded in folders. And I think many of us tend to download in a very greedy way. So I think there's this element of consumerism where we treat music as a one-dimensional thing, namely as a thing we ought to consume. And I think this also shows some ethically reprehensible quality. So there is nothing in the internet technology that forces us to be sharing or to be greedy. So the internet confronts us with our human nature,
yeah.
I think. Yeah.
So I think what we did here and in this whole module is discuss a lot of items where we can see how music and ethics and morality are interconnected. Perhaps you have your own examples and you want to share them with us. And I hope you are at least inspired by what we had to say about it. So, see you again.